Most the slides in my show are from a while ago on our other farm. We just moved in October, so I really don't have a whole lot of pictures of this farm, but everything we're doing there, we're gonna do down here. We're gonna look at it a little differently. When we moved to this farm, my husband and I were 30 and we had babies. Now we're in our mid-40s and we have teenagers and they're planning on having their own lives soon. So we're kind of looking at doing things so that it's manageable for us as we get older, which is kind of weird for us to think about. But so some of these pictures are winter pictures because the last time I did a presentation with these, it was winter. So I'm sorry to bring winter back. This is kind of a shot of what our sheep look like. We have two main kinds of sheep, Cornos, which are the kind of the woolly white faces, and we also have blue-faced Lesters, which I only see one in this picture. There's a couple of crosses. The only thing that really changed about our flock now is we have, this is a blue-faced Lester. We're starting to cross these blue-faced Lesters with the Teeswater and Wensley Dale. They're all British breed, long wool breeds. They make long curly fleece. So you think about the lambs you see at the fair, they have a very, what's called a downy wool. So it's a kind of a shorter, real springy. These just have long curly wool. They all come from Great Britain area, UK. They're all part of their crossbreeding scheme there. These would be considered sire breeds over there. Here they're considered a wool breed. The Cornos are a fine wool breed, sort of like a Merino, if you ever hear about that. If you look on sweaters and that, they're often advertised as Merino. So it's a really fine wool breed. Here's my husband looking a lot younger than he does now. But our goal for a long time was this, is we were going to raise the best fine wool there was in the Midwest, and we did do that for a long time. We now kind of are changing our focus. We still want to have the best wool out there, but we're kind of changing that, and we'll talk about that later. So then, this is kind of how, you know, this is the environment part of the sustainable agriculture thing here. We use a lot of intensive grazing. We do outwintering. We expect these animals to harvest their own feed, to spread their own manure. We're probably not quite as hardcore about it as we once were. That kind of goes back to us looking at how we're going to do things over the long haul. And also, if you see here, we were in the flat area before. Now everything we have is on a hillside. And getting hay out to them in the winter isn't going to be as easy as it once was. So we probably will not be outwintering them quite as much. We'll probably be more allotting, keeping them in lots in the winter, just for ease of feeding. As you see, this is what it looks like early spring where we would have fed the sheep. At this time, we probably had about 70 ewes. And we would just go out there and we'd feed them and we would spread the hay right on the ground. We didn't use hay feeders. Everything goes out there. So everything is spread out. So what do you think happens in that spot? You've got about a foot of hay left there. It's like a big mulch. And everything underneath there grows tons of worms, tons of fertilizer. And that spot will look kind of like that all year, but the next year that's going to be the greenest spot on the farm. And we didn't have to do anything or buy anything other than feed hay there. This is kind of an interesting picture. Again, this was late winter. The picture on the left shows our farm, and the picture on the right is the road or the field directly across from us. It's probably more meaning a little later in the, but everything in our place is covered with grass. And of course, that's all tilled. It's always eating some corn. So you see how much more isolating we're getting, how much more we're able to protect our soil and the microbes and to get into spring. At one time we did lamb in pasture. We just, about April, ewes went out, everybody had their babies on pasture. I don't do that anymore. I liked it during the day, I hated it at night. And I probably didn't have to go check on the girls at night, but it's just part of my nature to have to be out there if something's happening. So I didn't like that, but we did lamb on there. Now we kind of do more, we'll be doing more modified. Again, we'll be lambing on the hay pad where they overwintered. So we'll put that, we'll get a whole bunch of lambing pictures because everybody wants to see the cute lambs. yeah, so stop, wait, back up. Again, we rotational graze. So that means our sheep move every single day. We only give them as much grass as they can eat in a day, and then they move. We control them with, let me see back here, this is an electrified net. All our perimeter fences are a 5-wire high tensile. We put in an 20 joule low impedance fencer on there, which means if they touch that sucker, you hear it across the whole farm. and we need that because that net draws a ton of juice and it also shorts out pretty easy. The lambs, of course this year they're not, but we won't talk about this year, everything's kind of a mess. The lambs will move with their mothers all summer on grass. The cornrows aren't exactly known for real rapid gains. So by the time we pull them in this fall, they're 50, 60 pounds. And depending on how much grass we have left, either they'll go back, they'll have their own pasture, or we'll just sell them as feeders at that point, if they're not keeping as replacements. Because they're moving every day, we would haul water, my old truck. And we still have that water tank, and that's how we take water out to them. How Blake learned how to drive. Just following water. This is what we like our pasture to go look like when we go in. We're a firm believer in grazing tall. A lot of grazing literature is about, you know, you go in at this high, you take it down to this, and then you move them. We want it like this. We let them take whatever they want, and then they move. There's a couple reasons why that works for us. One, this farm in particular was really, really, really bad when we bought it. It was tired. And when we were trying the low graze, the ground never got covered. So it was always baked. So we had no microbes, we had no dung beetles, we had no worms. It was just baked ground, very little cover. When we finally figured out to start going in taller, things changed really rapidly. Another reason why it keeps the ground covered, it keeps it shaded, it's cooler. Another reason why we like this is sheep are really susceptible to parasites, especially if you're in a grazing situation. By letting them just take the leaves they want off the tops of the plants, we really avoided a lot of our parasite issues. So once we take the sheep in, this is pretty much what it would look like when they come back out. I think that's a come out. Yep. So they go in, and then it comes out looking like that. We see, if you had cattle on there, it would take those clumps down, but sheep just aren't big enough to do that, so we did it. Again, here you can see they take all that leaves off the stalks, they flatten it out, and a lot of people might get a little worried that you're leaving a lot of stuff out there on the pasture, but we found that our gains really increased once we started doing this, and the sheep are generally healthier. They the pasture, the soil was healthier, so we did that. The other thing is sheep really like beans. So other than Canadian thistle, they would eat just about everything. And they'll niggle kick with their thistle, they just want to eat it well enough to kill it. Then just some lambs for eating. Another real benefit we had is huge amount of wildlife on our place, and that to us was a plus. Maybe fox a plus for everybody. But we had everything. We had coyotes, we had bears, there's a bobcat, The wolves were within 5 miles of us up there. We never had any issues. Deer, but because of that, we also had some guard animals. We used llamas. You know, back then we had 4. We only have 2 of them now. We found that they work better in pairs. A lot of the logic on the llamas says one, but we really have found they work better in pairs. I'm just looking at these pictures and trying to explain this. This is shows in the fall. We will easily graze to mid-December, if not later, depending on the grass. By the time the lambs are off, we pretty much are really using some terrible stuff. We'll just let them eat it off. There we had a few cows in with them. Yeah, this is just kind of showing you what they were eating. Wasn't much there. That looks real good, but we could put them in a small area and they would take care of themselves. This shows that same area once they're done. We really probably kept, this was a low swampy area, so we would leave them in there for a while because it wasn't easy to divide up and they could
Do you raise cattle as well as sheep or?
At one time we had, when we first moved there, we had a herd of cattle. Now we just have a cow, and we keep her so that we have our own beef, and I kind of like cows, so we do. Right now in our place, we probably are going to try and bring our cow numbers back up a little bit to help with pasture management, because with moving, we cut our flock way back, and the cattle eat more. So we do wool. This next set of pictures is what shearing day is kind of like for us. As you can see, our sheep all, some pictures wear coats. It's just like this, a nylon coat. They wear it from shearing to shearing, except for our long wools, like the blue faces. They all get their coat in the fall when it's going up, when we start with hay. Here's a bunch of girls. They've got their coats off. They're waiting for shearing to see how clean they are. Here's our shearer. He can shear one of those sheep in about 5 minutes. This, after everyone is shorn, every fleece is taken and thrown out on a table like this. And this every year I have my mom and my aunt come. They help me. They take all the manure and the dirty parts off the fleece. And then each fleece is individually rolled and put into a plastic bag. And then we later will go back over every fleece and do what's called skirting over it again, where we'll take out anything dirty or icky, and then we then have it ready for our consumers. So we sell a lot of our fleece raw. Right now we get anywhere from $20 to $30 a pound raw for that fleece. And that's, each pommel view will give us about 4 to 5 pounds that is under the coat that we can sell at that price. Just to give you perspective, right now I think the going rate on final is what, about 260? Is it down now? Okay, it's down. So $1.20.
That's not necessarily clean.
That's it. Yeah, if we were just sending it, if we were hauling it to Dwayne's house to just go into the whirlpool, that's what we would get for it. We also take all other wool, or our skirted wool. I send it to a place in Michigan. They will do what's called combing, which is, and they bring, send it back to me in this way, all cleaned, and that it then is ready for anybody who would like to hand spin it. Or I use it to make my felted items, which is the next step. We also will take the fleece off the long wools, the Blue-faced Leicesters, the Wensleydale Tees waters, which this is kind of what it comes off of this year. It's kind of dirty with moving and everything. Wash it, and we'll dye it. People will buy this like crazy. Tyler is my official lock dyer. I set him loose with. We have our own, well, we don't have it quite set up yet, but we've always had facilities where we wash and dye our own wool. People will buy as little as just little handfuls of this and use it for whatever. Hats?
Crafts,
all kinds of crafts. They use it for a lot of different things.
Do you use commercial dye or do you make your
own dyes? That's probably the most frequent question I get is to what kind of dye I use. Everybody wants you to use the natural plant dyes.
And then you get the blonde owl colors.
Well, they're not always blonde, but you know, to get red, you can get red, but that's a very expensive Roundup bug dye. And to me, what's the difference if I'm ordering ground up bugs from Mexico or buying a chemical dye?
Mm-hmm.
And technically, depending on how you use them, they can both be toxic. So, yeah. But people want you to do that. They don't care if you're organic or it's grass-fed wool or anything, but they want you to be using natural dyes. But I really don't lose too many customers over it. So we also have the wool processed into, these are pre-felts. This is done for me by a lady in Iowa. But people again buy this for different crafts. I use this in my felting. So then I can go to the next step and I do felting, which is taking wool, if you've ever heard of wool shrinking a sweater and all that. Same concept, only I'll take the fibers like this, and then I make things like that. You know, you guys can look at all this stuff later if you want. Necklaces, vessels, purses, pretty much anything. So that's an example of different things I've made out of our wool. I feel like I've really rambled. So economic end of it, if we want to talk about that and the money end of it, we do okay. We're not making a ton of money, but we are making more than, you know, commercial prices. We started out with, I think at the most we probably had about 70 ewes at one time. With the move and the boys doing their own thing and that, we've cut back quite a bit, and I think right now I'm going to stay at the lower numbers and just more intensely market the products from fewer as opposed to more, just because I think in the end I'm going to come out better with fewer animals more intensely marketed than going for quantity.
And what avenues do you use for marketing?
For marketing? Oh, yeah, I didn't talk about that. We go to sheep and wool festivals. There's a Wisconsin sheep and wool festival down in Jefferson. It's a pretty large one. For several years, we did Shepherd's Harvest, which is a festival up by the Twin Cities. There's one in Iowa. We've gone to Michigan. The one thing about the festivals is I like them, but I'm also not someone who really thrives off of being with people that much all the time. Finding them a loner more and more. It used to be I was going to do one a month, but that's too much for me. So we do, I used to have a website, but I also found the pressure keeping up a website was too much, so I now just rely on Facebook and Instagram and that sort of stuff. And I have repeat customers that contact me and will buy from me every year. So,
Do they want the same fleece year after year from the same sheep?
I never guarantee that because, too many variables.
Yeah.
I could've called her. You know, she could've had some bad experience and we had a break in that fleece, or the coat could've come off and all of a sudden the fleece isn't, you know, worthy of, you know, that, and it goes into the process and stuff. So I never, ever do that. I know some people that do market that way, but I find it to be too risky. I don't want to explain culling, because a lot of my customers don't get that.
Mm-hmm.
They don't want to get that. Every sheep of ours has a name, because they don't, they want to buy fleeces with names. They don't want to buy fleeces with a number. So.
Just repeat your names, huh?
I could do that. Well, I'm starting to pull names back from way back. And when we had a lot of sheep got named on shearing day. But, and it, well, and just like everybody else said, everybody wants their fleece to have a story just as much as they want their lamb chop to have a story. We do sell some breeding stock, but I find that's not the most fun either. So I don't, I avoid that actually. So.
Okay. Any other questions for Jill?
Right. Thank you.